Good morning. We are here this morning first to honor God, and we are also here to celebrate the homegoing of our dearly beloved sister Edna DeGazon, better known as Auntie Darling. At this time, I'd like to call on our pastor, Pastor Gene Wooten.
Good morning. I want to, on behalf of the family, thank you so much for being here. As we look back and we celebrate the life of this precious lady today, thank you so much for the love and the support that you're showing to this family. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we bow before you today. We thank you for this day that you've given us, God. I thank you for this life, and I thank you for this precious lady. Thank you so much for the testimony of Auntie Darling. I ask, God, that you would be with us during this service. Comfort the family. We know that you never leave us or forsake us, Father. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please remain standing. It says in the book of John, chapter 15, verse 12, greater love has no one than this, that one would lay down his life for a friend. At this time, we have the privilege of singing, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. And I pray this morning that Jesus is your friend. Amazing grace, our chains are gone. If you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, this morning those chains are no more. My heart to fear, and grace Standing as we have the scripture reading by Miss Hannah Postery. Thank you.
Psalm 23 says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever."
Thank you. That was the word of the Lord. At this time, we'd like to call on Sister Andrew Wooden for the special selection. Please be seated, I'm sorry.
is weary. When troubles come, my heart burden be, then I am still, wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. Stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. Raise me up to more than I can be.
Before we go to the next section, I'd like to ask the congregation, everyone here, to do something. Close your eyes for 30 seconds and remember Auntie Darling smiling. Just close your eyes. She had an infectious, contagious smile. Close your eye for 30 seconds and let's picture her. Thank you. And now we'd like to call on Miss Leona DeGazon to read the eulogy.
Thank you, Sister Angela. That was a beautiful selection. Thank you so much for that. On behalf of the family, I would like to thank you all for coming out, dear friends, family near or far, those who are here with us in spirit. We really appreciate your prayers, your blessings, and may God be with you. Just thank you for being here to celebrate our diamond, Edna, Auntie Darling, DeGazon. As a mother, Edna gave life. As a grandmother, she gave a sense of who we are and where we came from. As a family member, she gave commitment and loyalty. If you knew her as a dear friend, she gave herself unconditionally. As a Christian, she gave her heart and her soul to Jesus Christ. Edna DeGazon entered this world on May 15, 1934, in Port of Spain, Trinidad, to Tali and Raja Sudin. She was the fourth of 12 children. The environment of love between her siblings taught her to share, sacrifice, and put others before herself. Her family affectionately called her darling, and the name described her sincere, genuine, and loving spirit. As she blossomed into a gorgeous flower, she met and married John DeGazon, who passed away on October 31st, 1998. This wonderful union produced five beautiful and gifted children, Leo Sr., Cheryl, David, Paula, and Sheldon. My father is Leo. He was the most gifted. Darling dedicated her life to the happiness of her children and the development of her family. She was a cheerful, fun-loving, kind-hearted woman, a people person whose infectious smile and laughter could light up a whole room. Whether it was her positive attitude, a funny joke, or her bubbly smile, she was just a delight to be around. Her role as a mother and a matriarch brought her extreme joy that transferred to her children and her grandchildren. Her grandchildren were her pride and joy. Each and every one of them shared a space in her heart. She made them all feel special and valuable. She was always excited when they called or visited her, and throughout the conversations, you can hear the joy in her voice. She was their confidant, their prayer partner, cooking instructor, advisor, and their very best friend. She was their rock. The grandchildren chose to call her Auntie Darling because she was too young and vibrant to be called grandmother. Before long, everyone would be calling her Auntie Darling. Auntie Darling's journey to St. Croix to be with her family and made the Virgin Islands her new home. Even though she crossed the ocean to make a new life, she lovingly remained in contact with her family and found unique ways to stay connected and emotionally linked with everyone. In St. Croix, Auntie Darling lived with her daughter, Paula, but ensured she spent time with all of her children and their families. It did not take much to make her happy. Once her family was together, she was content. Her passion was cooking and having family and friends over to eat and simply enjoy each other's company and presence. She entertained her guests and made everyone feel at home. Auntie Darling loved fashion. She always ensured she was properly dressed and looking good from head to toe. Even her matching jewelry was on point. As she matured, she still turned heads and exuded that unique Trini confidence. Auntie Darling loved to travel and visit family and made the effort to remain close to her siblings and their children. Auntie Darling eventually became focused on her faith and gave her life to Jesus Christ. She was a faithful member of the Free Will Baptist Church and proudly attended church with her children regularly. Auntie Darling, Sister Edna, was loved beyond measure by her church family. During fellowship time, there was always a line to get to her because everyone wanted to hug and kiss her and express their love to her. Attending church with her family made her extremely happy. Her happiest moments were when her five children accompanied her to church or celebrated her birthday. Though they were adults, she would look at them with such pride and joy as though they were still cuddled in her arms as babies. As Auntie Darling matured, she tried her best to manage several ailments. She was a fighter who tolerated more than the average person. She spent much time in and out of hospitals, but always bounced back with vigor and fortitude. Her caretakers loved her, and she formed great relationships with her medical teams. She always said that God knows the reason why he kept her around for so long, because so many times the doctors thought she didn't have too long to live, but God had his plan. The final days before she passed, she seemed very weak. You could look into her eyes and see that she wasn't herself. But even through her darkest moments, this extraordinary woman found the courage to put on a sweet smile on her face, a smile we would all remember dearly. On Sunday, June 4th, 2017, Auntie Darling tenderly answered when the Lord called her home. She slipped away to glory at Juan Luis Hospital, surrounded by family and church members. She is no longer with us in the flesh, but her beautiful spirit is alive in heaven. She remains in our midst, guiding, protecting, and loving us all as our new guardian angel. Auntie Darling is at peace, and she is free. And we can all hear her say, "Don't grieve for me, for now I'm free. I'm following the path God laid for me. I took his hand when I heard his call. I turned my back and left it all. I could not stay another day to laugh, to love, to work, or play. Task left undone must stay that way. I've found that peace at the end of the day. If my parting has left a void, then fill it with remembered joy. A friendship shared, a laugh, a kiss. Yes, these things too I will miss. Be not burdened with times of sorrow. I wish you the sunshine of tomorrow. My life's been fulfilled. I savored much. Good friends, good times, a loved one's touch. Perhaps my time seemed all too brief. Don't lengthen it now with undue grief. Lift up your heart and share with me. God wanted me now. He set me free." Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Leona DeGazon, for that eulogy. And I'm sure that all of you could add to a lot that was said there. I did look back when she was speaking, and I saw people agreeing with everything. She was quite a lady. Amen. At this time, let's stand, please. We're going to sing one more hymnal before the choir comes up. And we're going to sing about the goodness of God. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. At this time, I'd like to call up the Free Will Baptist Choir.
This world.
Great. And now we're going to have one, I Will Rise.
Thank you.
be to God. Amen. That song said, it did not say, I may rise or I might rise. It says, I will rise when he calls my name. Because today, I am sure that Sister Edna DeGazon's name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Sister Edna DeGazon has left memories in all of your lives. Many memories. And she has left them in a way that you will never forget her. The choir is now going to sing a song, We Will Remember. Thank you.
Your hands, we will stop and give you praise, for great is our faithfulness.
Yeah.
we will remember that God touched not only Sister Edna's heart, her relatives, her friends, all of those that came to know her. And she made it one of her jobs. I wouldn't even say a job. One of the things that she loved to do was tell people about Christ. At this time, we're going to have a short clip.
I thought that number one would surely be me. I thought I would be what I wanted. Thought I could build on life's sinking sand, but I can't even walk without you holding my hand.
My brothers and sisters, I want to thank God this morning because I'm a proud mother. I have my five children here with me. My eldest one is Leo DeGazon. He will come up, please. The second one is Cheryl that came in yesterday. The third one is Paula. The third one is David. The fourth one is Paula, and my baby is Sheldon. I thank God that I'm a proud mother to have my five children alive. I am 82 years. I have all my grandchildren alive, my great-grandchildren. I thank God for all of them. Okay.
I'm sure you're wondering why the big deal, right? Most of you, some of you know, but most of you wouldn't know. Several years ago, my mom had some heart attacks. She's been in hospital in Puerto Rico and just barely hanging on for life. And God saved her of that. The doctor several years ago told her that she didn't have very long to live. And it's what, four years, is it? It's about 5 years, I think, since the doctors gave up on her, and she's still going. And so we're thankful that we still have our mom. Man, God is awesome. He is awesome.
I thank God for all of them.
Thank you. That was quite a memory, amen. At this time, I'd like to call up on Brother Brown with a family tribute. Brother Brown.
Good morning to everybody. I don't even know if I can make it, but I'm going to try, because this lady had meant so much to me. I could remember coming in, and as I come in, she will said to me, "Brother Brown, before you leave today, don't leave before you see me." And you don't know what I'm going to get before I leave, eh? I get in something I call a mini roti. When I go to work and I eat my mini roti, they say, "Boy, this ain't no mini roti, they call them doubles." Forever, Sister Edna been always happy and everything. And she always said to me, Brother Brown, when you sing sweet, you don't even need music. Now I'm going to try to sing now. I have to. I went to a house where I used to go. The grass has grown up and covered the doors, but someone across the street said he knew whom I see. But they don't live here anymore. Oh no, they are somewhere around the throne of God, somewhere around the throne of God. I keep searching, keep on searching, until I shall find them. They are somewhere around God's throne. Then I went to the church where they used to go. The preacher, he was still there. He met me at the door. He says, I know who you are, and I know who you're looking for. But they don't come here anymore. No, they don't. They are somewhere around the throne of God, somewhere around the throne of God. I keep searching, keep on searching, until I shall find them. They are somewhere around God's throne. Yes, they are. They are somewhere around the throne of God, somewhere around the throne of God. I keep searching, keep on searching, until I shall find them somewhere around God's throne. Thank you.
Amen. Amen. We are looking forward to the time when
we'll be standing around God's throne. At this time, I'd like to call on Miss Cherise Romo for the family tribute. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Not going to do an intro because I have to make it through two pages. So, Auntie Dallin, or my grandmother Edna, for those of you who believe in something more traditional, was far beyond any matriarch. Loving mother of Leo, Cheryl, David, Paula, and Sheldon, she was the glue that held us all together. She was my confidant, my protector, my comforter, and my source of strength. Much like my own parents, she was my world. One out of 15 grandchildren, I proclaimed to be her favorite. While Runny and Mossy earned the title by birthright, she would say, okay, Cherise, never really disagreeing or agreeing for that matter. I'm sure my mom, Aunt Paula, and uncles also fought over who was her favorite, but the truth is my grandmother had a heart so big we were all her favorite. Whether you were her favorite choice to ask to go get the thing from the thing, or a glass, and I do mean a glass of water, after she just left the kitchen, by the way, we all had an important role in her life. With shoulders shrugged to the ears, I can hear my brother Mullen and my cousins Marcus and Dwayne snickering. Auntie Dallin, what thing? Hopefully you found that thing. Because as a grandchild of Edna DeGazon, you were expected to know what she was referring to, as she apparently anointed us with the gift of ESP. Michael, Ashley, and Angeli were spared somewhat from the wrath, but had equally important roles. As young children, we could be certified nurses, as blood sugar readings, insulin injections, and foot rubs were all things we became pros at. My grandmother was the best storyteller. It was how she taught us those important life lessons. As a child, I can remember her telling stories of her three brothers, Coffee, Sonny, and Ralph, and six sisters, Thelma, Janet, Sylvia, Sandra, Barbara, and Jean. She would also tell us stories of how many times she would have to split an egg to ensure all of her children ate. While we would chuckle at the thought, it instilled in us the values and morals that we could never replace. We learned from early on the value of a dollar, TT or US, and that the things that meant the most in life could not be bought. Being the second eldest surviving sibling of the Sudin clan, her caring, nurturing spirit and leader-like qualities came very natural. She was the best cook. No one, and I mean no one, sorry, Uncle Leo and Mommy, could make a stew pour quite like she could. And let's not talk about the bread and the ham during Christmas. Christmas was by far her favorite holiday. So many of our family traditions were centered around the holiday season. Paranging from house to house with bottle and fork in hand, Auntie Paula singing the Spanish remix of I Want a Piece of Pork and Mama Bake Your Johnny Cake are some of the fondest memories I had growing up. Christmas time, or any time we were all together, was filled with so much laughter, and Auntie Dallin had the biggest laugh of them all. I'm sure you could hear it right now. Family was everything to her, and she built unique bonds with each of us. There were no in-laws in our family. I would often hear strangers say she looked so young when they learned her age. There was no secret on what kept my grandmother's youthful glow. It was us. And quite honestly, the joy of being surrounded by her family was the medicine that kept her alive. As her health began to deteriorate, time with us, and particularly her five children, became even more important. In January 2009, we got our first big scare, which landed us in Pavier Cardiovascular Intensive Care Unit in San Juan, Puerto Rico. It was the first time I remember hearing the words, heart disease. We prayed and prayed and prayed that she would make it out of it. And just when we lost hope, God granted us a miracle. My grandmother was just that, a miracle. With faith on her side and the tune of Amazing Grace in her head, she bounced back and continued to march to the beat of her own drum, surpassing every doctor's expectations. She never allowed her diagnosis to break her spirit, because she knew as a child of the King, she would one day have everlasting life in him, and one sweet day, this day, she would have no more pain. In September 2014, things took an unexpected turn for the worse. While visiting her hometown of Trinidad and Tobago, she fell seriously ill, suffering a massive heart attack. The doctors at the time gave her a 50-50 chance of survival. With her children, grandchildren, and other close relatives by her side, she closed her eyes and she prayed, praying not for herself, but for each of us. She prayed that we would be at peace with one another and stand united as a family. God knew her work on earth was not complete and saved her life once more. But that didn't stop her from continuously preparing us for this day that she would no longer be here on earth. She gave us our blessing and asked the same from each of us. Put your trust and faith in God because He is in control. Amen. Over the next couple of years, her disease began to show the wear on her body. She became less and less mobile, but still fought to keep her independence. Right, Auntie Paula? That was the Sudine in her blood. Very strong will. Even noticeably less able, she continued to be present and live every moment to the fullest. She knew that these moments would be the memories that we had, that we would need to get us through this very difficult time. So with her prescriptions in her purse clutched under her arm and her walker in her hand, she was there for all of those important moments. Sunday worship, birthday celebrations, graduations, promotions, weddings, and even the birth of my baby boy, Maddie. The Easter and Christmas cantatas were her favorite Sundays. She loved watching her children and grandchildren perform. It was her proudest moment. There was something particularly about when Marcus sang. She would often raise from her seat and meet him mid-stage, breaking him into tears, of course. She could honestly listen to him sing, "I Pledge Allegiance to the Lamb," over and over and over again. August 2016, she would take what would be her last trip away from home. This time, not for a celebration of any sort, but it was to be by the side of her eldest son, Leo, as he underwent major surgery. It didn't matter what her condition was. She always put others first. And like any mother, her children's needs always superseded her own. This wasn't the first, nor would it be the last time that she sat tirelessly at the hospital bedside of one of her children, or grandchildren for that matter. I remember her being there each time Uncle Sheldon dislocated his shoulder, when Uncle David went through many life-saving surgeries, and most recently when her eldest grandchild, who was much more like a son, Runny, laid unconscious in a hospital bed. I could only admire her strength and grace as she dealt with it all. She never complained, so I knew her final days were approaching, as she would often speak about the pain and discomfort she was feeling. She tried to disguise the pain with the witty sense of humor, but I think we all knew that the days we had left with her were numbered. May 3rd, 2017 seems like when it all spiraled downhill. The news of her baby sister Janet's passing left a hole in her heart so big that all the love in this world could not fill. 2 hospital stays and several days of her vitals being up and down, she grew more and more tired. She made with her peace and once again gave us her blessings as she prepared herself to step into eternal life. On Sunday, June 4, 2017, at 10 a.m., with family and friends and church members by her side, she took her last breath. While I know she could not speak in those final moments, in my heart I know she transitioned into the light, humming the lyrics to "It Is Well With My Soul." My grandmother will forever be remembered by those who knew her for her infectious, most beautiful spirit. The tune of "Pink Eye Baby," or "Blue Eye Baby," as Mason calls it, still runs on repeat in my head. The makeshift baby bouncer in her lap and pony rides on her knees will be memories that will live with me for a lifetime. The scent of her favorite Jergens lotion and freshly placed mothballs can still be smelled as you entered her room. I can clearly picture your favorite dinner mint and candies shoved in the bottom of your purse, which I needed, by the way, 2 seconds ago. There will never be a soul more beautiful than my grandmother. And because of how she lived her life, a part of her will remain in each of us until the end of time. To honor her life and her legacy, choose to love deeply, forgive often, laugh infectiously, and carry a song in your heart so that when your blue skies are gray, the light that lives inside of us now will shine bright. In looking through her personal belongings, I found a handwritten prayer that I believe she left for us to be read on this day. It reads, "Be strong, be courageous. Fear not, for I am with you. God is able and he loves you. He will give you his healing touch. Fear not, do not be afraid. Rest in paradise, my beautiful grandmother. We will love you for 1,000 years and 1,000 more. Thank you."
Thank you, Ceres. And I just want to add something short here. One of the things that Sister Edna never wanted to transmit to anyone is sadness. And why I say that is Paula and Dwayne, Marcus, a lot of y'all out there had the task. Anytime she's rushed to the emergency room, you know, to tell friends, pastor, all of us around here that, you know, she's in the emergency room. So, you know, we'll leave what we are doing, and we'll go to the emergency room. And when we go there she is. And she will say, that, like, to me, "Hey, Chris, what happened, boy?" "I mean, I came to visit someone sick." But that is, you all will hear of accounts of that throughout. She's a person, as soon as she's able to speak, she start to smile and she continue the way she is. And let me tell you, there are many times I and others have gone to pray for her. And guess what? She ended up praying for us. You know, so that was the kind of person Sister Edna was. And I know she probably has a special role up in heaven there. She's probably organizing stuff up there, you know. At this time, we want to call on her grandson, Dwayne, with a special selection.
That you're my hero, the wind beneath my wings. Did I ever tell you you're my hero? You're everything, everything I wish I could be. Oh, I can fly higher than an eagle, 'cause you are the wind.
Sing the song first. This song is so true for many of us, family, friends, just anyone that came in contact with her. My grandmother, she definitely was the wind beneath our wings, and she essentially made you feel like you can fly, you can soar, you could do just about anything. In addition, I mean, she was there for you no matter what. You'd never hear her complain. She'd always have that smile on her face. You hear everybody say it over and over again. And, you know, she would be greatly missed. But there's one thing that we know. As the last part, she flied away. She went straight up, you know. I mean, and I would like to encourage any one of you guys, family, friends, anyone, that if you don't know the Lord as your personal Savior, please come to know Him. That's definitely what you would want as well. So it's a hard time for the family, but we're all going to keep strong. We're going to stick together, and we're going to make it through all. Although she may not be here, we can carry on the legacy. All right. We can keep the love and peace, and guess what? She may be gone, but we can see her. Anyone can see her through our family. If you look at every one of us, you're just going to see her showing. So keep strong during this time. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dwayne. We want to call on another friend by the name of Rupert James, better known as Fighter. Come and do your thing, sir.
Good morning. I met Darlene in Trinidad 1973, and she made me feel so wanted that She leave and she came up to St. Croix. And to every time, she let me feel so wanted, how nice and kind she was to me, that I never forget her. She came up here, and I believe she's my best friend. She came up here sometime, I don't even remember my birthday, and she will call me and said, "Mr. Fighter," that's what she called me, "Mr. Fighter, happy birthday." And when she have those special cook, she will call me and says, "I'm going to cook today." One time I asked a man, "What is the best thing you love into a woman?" He says, "If she's a good cook." And I know Darlene is a good cook. When I was in Trinidad, she used to cook some fowl foot, the foot of the fowl. And she could not give me a plate unless you have 2 foot in it. Some foot, I like it. So she was a wonderful friend of mine. She will call me. She never get vexed. She will call me. I said, you're not coming to look for me? I said, I'm coming, man, I'm coming. And if even I don't reach, she's not going to get vexed. She'll still call me again for me to come and look for her. She don't call me for nothing. She just wants me to come and see her all the time. She was a wonderful lady, wonderful friend of mine. Built your mansion next door to Jesus and tell the angels I'm coming home. It doesn't matter who lives around me, just hope my mansion sit near God's throne. I have no parcel, no earthly treasure. My heaven will prove when I got home. My mansion yonder on the hills of glory. So hope your mansion sit near God's throne. So build your mansion next door to Jesus and tell the angels I'm coming home. It doesn't matter who lives around me, just hope your mansion sit near God's throne. My mother mansion will be profound me across the golden avenue. She was the first one to teach me of heaven and the very first one to tell me about you. So build your mansion next door to Jesus and tell the angels I'm coming home. It doesn't matter who lives around me, just hope your mansion sit near God's throne.
Yes, that's one of the promises in the Bible. He said that he's going to go and prepare a place for you. And that place is a mansion or mansions. He said he's going to be there and you all will be there also. And if God promised or Jesus promised you all something, I know for a fact Jesus will not break any promise. Amen? Sister Edna would not like to have anything, whether it's at a home, in the savannah, by the sea, without the word of God. Amen? And at this time, I'd like to call on her pastor, the pastor of Free Will Baptist Church, Pastor Gene Wooten. Please come to the mic.
Good morning again. While I was preparing for today, I couldn't think of any verse, any passage that would describe our dear sister better than Philippians 1:21. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Let's pray. Father, we bow before you today. We thank you for this time to celebrate this precious life, Father. I ask that you would be with us as we open your word. Teach us. Draw us close to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you've never read this portion of Scripture, never done any study on it, you read that verse and you think, you know, that's a pretty good verse for me, to live is Christ, to die is gain. You have to understand that it's written by Paul, and it's written from imprisonment. He was, at this point in his life, chained to a Roman guard. He wasn't allowed to do anything. He was a prisoner in this life. And he writes this verse, you know, through the direction of the Holy Spirit, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." And as we're sitting here listening to the stories and the testimonies, and if you knew, Auntie Darling, you knew that was exactly what her life was about. It was about Christ. And you know what? To die was gain. The last several years of her life, she was a prisoner of this flesh. We heard how, you know, her health was deteriorating and it was getting more difficult for her, but she always had that smile. Always. I would come to visit her at home or in the hospital, and she always smiled. And you know, I mean, she was in pain. She was tired. She would say, "Well, I didn't sleep well last night, but God is good." And she would always, and it wasn't just empty words. This was what she believed, what she lived, what she knew, church. "For me to live is Christ, to die is gain." So how could she say those words? How could Paul say those words being imprisoned? How could we say those words? You would flip over to John chapter 3. You read about, you know, one of the most famous verses in the Bible is, of course, verse 16. But it is Nicodemus coming to Christ and saying, "What do I need to do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus says, "Well, you need to be born again." And he said, "Well, how can I, an old adult, be born again? You can't be born." And Jesus said, "You need to be born of the flesh and of the Spirit." And so that is where we pick up in verse 16. It says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." And verse 17 is such an important verse. "For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." And that is how we know that Auntie Darling could say this verse, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." Because she gave her life to God, and she did it through Jesus Christ. John 14:6 tells us that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through him. And so she gave her life to God. She asked God to forgive her of her sins and asked him to come into her life. And he did. And she was changed. The New Testament also tells us that when we do that, we are a new creation. Old things have passed away. All things have become new. And that is how we can say with confidence that if God chooses to leave us here for 5, 10, 50 more years, "For me to live is Christ." Hopefully in my life, I'm pointing people to Christ with everything I do. And you know what? When I die, that's gain. I mean, that is gain. Number one, so what do we gain? Number one, we gain a better body. We gain a better body. We know that this body is, it's made of clay, it's flesh, and it's breaking down. I know as I get older, I, you know, have these moments when I'll say something and I'll think, "Oh man, I remember hearing my dad saying that when I was a kid." My dad used to always say, "Son, don't get old. There's no future in it." You know, when you get up out of a chair and you, it takes you a few minutes to stand up maybe. When you're younger, like I have four boys, if you don't know, I have four young boys, and they hurt themselves and like 2 minutes later, they're fine running around and everything's good. But when you get to be older and you hurt something, it just stays hurt for the rest of your life pretty much. You feel it every time it gets cold or every time you sit too long or something. It just stays broke, right? The gain that Paul is talking about that we know Auntie Darling experienced a week and a day ago when she peacefully closed her eyes and the next time she opened them, she saw her Savior. I mean, just think about that moment. We were in the room and it was, I can't explain it, it was just the most peaceful passing I've ever been around. She just, we looked over and the monitor was zero. And at that moment when she closed her eyes and she opened them, there was Jesus. There was her gain, her new body. The Bible says we will be known as we are known, but you're going to have a new body. Your scars are going to be gone. I've got all kinds of scars on my body. I could tell you lots of stories, but those are all going to be gone, and I will still be known as I am known. You'll know me in heaven as I am, and we gain. The gain is that new body. No more aches, no more sorrows, no more pain, no more fatigue. When Christ was on this earth, you know, he got tired. He hurt. We see him crying, and he bled for us. But when we gain, no more. No more sorrow. Secondly, we gain a better home. We gain a better home. The verses that Chris was mentioning just a minute ago, we find in John 14, in verses 1 through 3, Jesus says, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also." Jesus was talking to his disciples and saying, you think this life is beautiful? Listen, St. Croix is the absolutely, without a doubt, not even a close call, the most beautiful place I've ever lived in my life. It is absolutely beautiful, and you can see God's splendor in creation in so many ways on this island. But if we've given our life to God through his Son, Jesus Christ, when we close our eyes and we open them, we gain a new home. A home that can't even, I mean, this St. Croix won't even be in the conversation. It won't be like, oh, I miss St. Croix. I miss home. Because heaven is our home. We gain a new home. No matter what your house is like, I mean, maybe you live in just the finest of a mansion. I mean, you know, 16 bedrooms and all this. I don't know. But it doesn't even compare to what God has prepared for us. We gain a better home. And it's only through Jesus Christ. So we gain a new body, we gain a new home. Paul, later on in that chapter, you can hear him longing for it. You know, for 21, he says, "For me to live is Christ, to die is gain." 23, he says, "For I am a strait betwixt two, having a desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is far better." He was a prisoner, and he was saying, look, I know what God has promised me, and that is much better. I want to stay because I know that you need me. But man, I'm telling you, to die is gain. To die is gain. We gain a new body, we gain a new home. And number three, we gain that inheritance that we hear of in the Bible so much. That inheritance. There's no comparison to what that final reward is if you're a child of God's. If you've given your life to him, if you've asked him to forgive you of your sins, and you've accepted the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, the Bible says that heaven is your home. We all want that promise of heaven. Everybody. I've never met anybody that says, you know, hey, what? Everybody wants the promises of God, but we've got to go through Jesus Christ, and then to die is gain. That better, that new body, that better home, and that eternal reward. Number four, we gain a better fellowship. We gain a better fellowship. When you read Hebrews chapter 11 and you read about, you know, the hall of faith, and all of these people through Scripture that we read about, you'll get to see them. Just imagine walking through heaven and then looking up and seeing Joshua. And then looking over, and then there's Auntie Darling. And then over here's Moses. The better fellowship, it is about our Savior and seeing him face to face. To die is gain. When we are able to see God, we're able to see Jesus, that fellowship is not even going to compare. Listen, when we have fellowship time around here, you heard about it in the eulogy, how we would all line up at this pew right here and wait to just be able to hug, just to be able to talk to Auntie Darling. The fellowship time is so sweet. But the fellowship in heaven, my goodness. You know, every time, the Bible says, every time a sinner comes to Christ, that there is rejoicing in heaven. So when one person ask God to forgive them of their sins, there's a party in heaven over that. And when we die and we understand what that means to gain, we'll be a part of that fellowship. And it'll be so sweet. And there'll be no end to it. For me to live for money is loss. For me to live for myself is loss. For me to live for ambition is loss. For me to live for whatever sin that I find most enjoyable is loss. But for us to live for Christ is gain. For us to live is Christ. To die is gain. We see this lived out in Auntie Darling's life, and I hope that you understand. If the great news is, if you've never accepted Christ, today is the day of salvation. Nothing would make her more happy in this world than to know that people were led to her Savior at her homegoing service. And then one day you can say, but to die is gain. When I close my eyes, I know that I will open them and see my Savior. Church, I hope that you've given your life to Christ. Let's pray. Father, we bow before you again. We thank you for your word. God, I ask that you would teach us what it really means that for us to live is Christ and to die is gain. As we continue this service, be with this sweet family, Father. Comfort them. Continue to guide and direct them every step along the way. We thank you for the time that we had with Auntie Darling, and we look forward to seeing her again one day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor. Before we sing the last hymnal, I don't want to add anything to Pastor's message. I just have a short phrase to make. If there's any one of you in here this morning that do not know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, don't die. That is pure and simple. You don't know Jesus as Lord and Savior, don't die. Okay? Before we sing that, when we all get to heaven, you know it's not everyone's going to heaven. That's why I had to put in that part there. As soon as the celebration here is over, we're going to go straight to the interment, will be at King's Hill Cemetery. So I would like to ask you all to stand. Please stand. I want, when we're singing this song, I want to get complaints from Sunny Isles that some noise, they're hearing some noise from Zion Hill. It will be our voices that they'll be hearing, okay? When we all get to heaven. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing in mercy and his grace. In the mansion bright and blessed, he prepared for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trust in serving every day. Just one glimpse of him in glory will the toils of life repay. Oh, when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, so
rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and shout the victory.
Let's sing it again one more time. Stop. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing his mercy and his grace. Sing the mansion bright and blessed. He prepared for us a place. Oh, when we all get to heaven, day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and shout the victory while we the pilgrim pathway. Cloud will overspread the now when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sound. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trust in serving every day. Just one glimpse of him in glory will the toys of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us. Soon his beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open. We shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.